Psalm 61 says, "My soul waits silently for God alone, for my expectation is from Him. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be moved. And God is my salvation and my glory, the rock of my strength, and my refuge is in God. Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us too."
All right, y'all, stand up. All right, before we go here, I want y'all to do something for me. All right, before we go, in the middle of this song that we're getting ready to play, I'm going to say 1, 2, 3, 4, and everybody go, "Here we go now." All right, let's practice.
1, 2, 3, 4.
There you go. Try it again.
1, 2, 3, 4.
All right, just do that in song.
Every day, you're the same, never change, never.
The wait is over. Pick up your copy today of Inoculation. The news released by the hockey ball holding back, Tall Man. Now available at stores.
WZIT, Papa Boyle speaking. How may I help you? Yes, I am the manager. What did you find offensive about it? Oh, I see. Well, in her defense, she did eat it after the show was over. No, ma'am, I apologize and I will not let it happen again. And to show how much we appreciate your input, I will give you a certificate for one free meal at Papa Boyle's Pizza Palace. Hello? Ma'am? Hey, Kelly, doing all right? Great. Kelly, what? I have a new program on the log at 3:10 today. Watch out for the guy as he comes in, okay? Hey, Kelly, have you seen the new FCC notice on the board? Right. What does it say? Kelly, are you hearing me? Then answer me!
You say something?
No, I was just flapping my lips to make a breeze. Look, I have to go to the restaurant. I have a new program that comes on at 3:10. Watch out for the guy as he comes in, okay?
3:10?
And I expect you to take care of him.
Mr. Boyle, that's during my music show.
That's right.
During your non-sponsored?
Not paying music show. I can't be a sponsor ever since you pulled that trick with the chicken.
My best work. But anyways, it was going to be fried. Anyways, you know?
But not in a miniature electric chair.
Hey, I'm a shock jock. What'd you expect?
I expect you to make this new program sound good.
Please. You cannot put it on.
Forget about it. The time is already sold. Anyway, it's only a 5-minute show, it won't kill you.
Hope not, people tune out quick. What is it, a fishing show?
In a manner of speaking, it's a preacher.
A preacher? You cannot be serious.
We gotta pay the bill somehow. And the advertisers aren't exactly knocking down our door. So that means selling some time to some naive preacher who thinks he can save someone in 5 minutes? So be it. I'm not going to be the one who tells him he's wasting his money. His name is Reverend Bobby Penn. He'll be here any minute. Here's his music intro. Make sure to use it. He recorded it himself.
It's going to reek, I can tell.
Remember, the airtime he is buying pays for your salary today. So no preacher, no payday. Get it? Treat him right.
What a bummer. A preacher coming into a perfectly good Sunday. Why can't these stupid fundies stay on their own radio station where they belong? I mean, what makes them think that anybody else wants to listen to them? Goes on air in a few minutes. Maybe he won't even show and I'll be off the hook. Afternoon. This is WZIT radio station where the hits like this just keep on popping up. I'm Kelly Whitehead. The last half hour of nonstop music was brought to you by Oxy 500. Be Foxy, use Oxy. This is 305. Stay tuned to the best of today's alternative rock.
You're on the air, so I tried to sneak in. I'm sorry I'm late. I got caught in a traffic jam.
All right, I'm Kelly Whitehead. I'll be helping with the program.
Nice to meet you.
Here's your microphone. Stay pretty close to it.
Alright, let's see, did Mr. Bull give you the music for the introduction of the program?
Yeah, got it ready to go.
Wonderful. My wife plays the organ on that music. You're going to love that.
I'm sure I will.
Hello there, I'm the Reverend Bobby Penn, and and I'd like to welcome you to our first broadcast of the Sunday Sermon Program. Thank you for joining me, and I'd like to invite you to think with me on the subject, how to find happiness. Many people today are looking for every minute. Then, friend, make Jesus your Savior. Follow me in this prayer and mean it in your heart. Dear Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know I'm lost, but I'm asking you to come into my heart and save me. I believe that you are the Son of God, that you died on the cross for my sins, and you rose again. Forgive me of my sins and save me, dear Jesus. Heavenly Father, I come to you through your Son. Accept me now in his name, and someday take me home to heaven to be with you. Amen. My friend, if you prayed that prayer with me, your name is written in heaven right now, and you are a child of God. For the Bible says, but as many as receive him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them who believe on his name. The next thing to do is to tell somebody about your new faith in Christ. For we read in Romans 10:10, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. God bless you as you begin your new life in Christ. I'm the Reverend Bobby Penn, and I'd like to invite you again next week at this same time to listen to the Sunday Sermon Program.
I did it, preacher. I really did it.
You sure did, Kelly. Congratulations. Praise the Lord.
Oh, gosh. Papa Boyle will kill me if he hears that air. Hey. You've been listening to the Sunday Sermon. Join in again next week, and invite all your friends to...
Give them the words, and just to speak in your name, Lord. Please, let's just worship you and all that we have in your name.
Thank you. we keep coming back to church, and my life has been awesome, and I know that Christ is always on my side, but before I accepted Christ, it wasn't always.
Different dreams that have been shattered and all, and it's just saying how there's hope for every man and every person. It's saying like me or you or the person beside you or behind you or anybody, everybody goes through things, and there's hope for that, and there's always a way out. And then at the end, it just opens it.
So I'm going to start in 1 Samuel 18:1. It says, "Now it came about when he had finished speaking to Saul that the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as himself." So I want to stop right there. Jonathan is Saul's son, and through having David in his household, he just had him and David were inseparable. You know, they were best buddies, and they were just best friends. And so in verse 2 it says, "Saul took him that day and did not let him return to his father's house. Then Jonathan made a covenant with David, because he loved him as himself. Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that was on him and gave it to David with his armor, including his sword and his bow and his belt." That covenant that he had with David, that's very important to the lesson. So you don't have to turn there, but I want to read you a little bit more about it in 1 Samuel 20. Starting at 14, it says, "If I am still alive, will you not show me the loving kindness of the Lord that I may not die? You shall not cut off your loving kindness from my house forever, not even when the Lord cuts off every one of the enemies of David from the face of the earth." So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, "May the Lord require it at the hands of David's enemies." Jonathan made David vow again because of his love for him, because he loved him as he loved his own life. So Jonathan and David had a very serious commitment. They loved each other, you know, they were best friends, and they promised that they'd always show love and kindness to each other and to their families. So continuing in 1 Samuel 18, in verse 5, it says, "So David went out where Saul sent him, and prospered. And Saul set him over the men of war. And it was pleasing in his sight, in the sight of all people, and also in the sight of Saul's servants. It happened as they were coming, when David returned from killing the Philistine, that the women came out of all the cities of Israel singing and dancing to meet King Saul, with tambourines, with joy, and with musical instruments. The women sang as they played and said, 'Saul has slain his thousands, and David his 10,000s. Then Saul became very angry, for this saying displeased him, and he said, "They have ascribed to David 10,000s, but to me they have ascribed thousands. Now what more can we have but the kingdom? Can he have the kingdom?" Saul looked at David with suspicion from that day on. So when Saul came back from war, he was ready to be glorified. He wanted all of his people to come praise him and just think, "Look at this mighty warrior." But instead, his servant David was praised more. They said, "Saul killed his thousands and David his 10,000s. They looked at David so much higher than Saul. And Saul grew so envious and jealous that he sought to kill David. And for the rest of David's life, until the point that Saul died, Saul was after him. Jonathan, Saul's son, actually helped David escape. And later on, Jonathan was killed in war, and so were his brothers. And Saul was so upset that he took his own life. Now, at that point, David became king. Now I want to start with 2 Samuel 9. In verse 1 it says, "David asked, 'Is there anyone still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake?'" So here we see David honoring his covenant with Jonathan. You know, David's king now. He's got it made. He's got everything he could ever want. He's got all the money, the whole kingdom. He can do whatever he wants. But yet, instead of getting so overjoyed and getting so caught up in this, he remembers his covenant with his old buddy. And he doesn't just wait for one of Jonathan's friends to come along and he's like, "Oh, here's a lollipop," you know. He goes and he seeks out Jonathan, he seeks out Jonathan's children. In verse 2 it says, "Now there was a servant of Saul's household named Ziba. They called him to appear before David, and the king said to him, 'Are you Ziba?' 'Your servant,' he replied. The king asked, 'Is there no one still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show God's kindness?' Ziba answered the king, There is still a son of Jonathan. He is crippled in both feet. Now in that time, I want you to understand that to be crippled, you were considered an outcast to society. You were considered worthless. You didn't deserve to live. And this was Mephibosheth. So you can imagine how he felt when the king called him. In verse 4, David says, "Where is he?" the king asked. Ziba answered, "He is at the house of Machir, son of Amiel, in Lodabar." So King David had him brought from Lodabar, from the house of Machir, son of Amiel. When Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, came to David, he bowed down to pay him honor. David said, "Mephibosheth, your servant," he replied. "Don't be afraid," David said to him, "for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan. I will restore to you all the land that belonged to your grandfather Saul, and you will always eat at my table." Now, I want you to understand the reason David said to not be afraid was because at this time, if when you became king, every family member of the previous kingdom you would have killed and feared that they would try to come and take the kingdom back. So basically, Mephibosheth would have been killed by David if it weren't for his covenant with Jonathan. David would have sought him out for a completely different reason. And so you can imagine how Mephibosheth felt when he was brought before the king and he laid at his feet and he said, "Your servant." I mean, he was terrified. He thought he was going to lose his life. And David, he said, "You're going to eat at my table regularly." And that was shocking because that's like adopting him into the family. It's a big deal back then to eat at someone's table. Mephibosheth bowed down and said, "What is your servant that you should notice a dead dog like me?" Now in that time, dogs were known as just gross animals. You know, they roamed the streets, they dug through trash to find food. You know, they didn't wear little ribbons in somebody's house. They were nasty animals, nobody could stand them. And Mephibosheth considers himself a dead dog because he's a broken person, you know, he's a cripple. Society has nothing to do with him. And up until this point, he was in fear of his life, and that's what he feels like. He was unworthy to dine at David's table. There was no reason for David to have him at his table. But David never once mentioned Mephibosheth's disabilities. He never said, "You know, I'm sorry." He just didn't mention it. He overlooked it. And in the big picture, guys, no matter how sinful we are, if we accept Christ, we can dine at his table, at the Lord's table. And at his table, just like Mephibosheth did, we won't see our sin, we won't see our pain, we won't see our brokenness. We are not worthy to dine at his table, guys, because the first time we sinned, which I promise you, was when you were a small child. That's when we just gave up our rights to be with the Lord. But God gives us a chance to anyways. Just like David, Mephibosheth had no reason to be at David's table, but he was. God will overlook our sin. He won't see our sin, you know. He won't be like, "Remember when you did so-and-so?" We won't have to worry about that anymore. And the Lord allows us to dine at his table by sending his son Jesus to die for us. Guys, there's a lot of brokenness in this room. I know it. And there's a lot of brokenness in my youth group. We're all broken people. We're living in hard times. We all live sinful lives. I live a very sinful life. I sin so much. And when I think about it, when I look back on my day at night, I just feel so ashamed because of the way I live my life. It's not a life that God would give me. We all live those kinds of lives. We're broken. But we don't have to see our brokenness. And one other thing I want to mention, when people don't know how to deal with their brokenness and their pain, they try to take it out on themselves. And guys, we do not have to do that, ever. Jesus had nails driven through his hands so that a razor blade would never have to touch our wrist, guys. We do not have to deal with our brokenness ourselves. Jesus came and died, so we won't have to do that. It's pointless. When he died, he gave us hope. No matter how sinful we are, no matter how broken we are, we're like dead dogs. That's how we're living. Like Mephibosheth felt. That's how we feel. That's how I feel. we can dine at the Lord's table still. And at the Lord's table, guys, our bleeding rest will be healed, and we won't feel broken anymore.
He was broken, he was crippled, he was dropped by his nursemaid, and that's how he became crippled. And here he, with all our brokenness, even with all the baggage, even with all the things in our life, anything that we've been through, gone through, whatever sin, we still get to dine at the table of the Lord. And that's an awesome thing to think about. But my question is, how many people in here, how many of us have been carried to the table? How many of us have been brought to that point where we have been brought to the Lord's table because we have come to know Christ as our Savior? Just want to ask you for just a moment, everyone, just bow your heads and close your eyes and just... Mephibosheth came to David and he said, "I am a dead dog." Mephibosheth realized that he could do nothing on his own. And you know what? We can't do anything on our own. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Every one of us, by nature and by choice, is a sinner. Sin is disobedience. Sin is missing the mark. Sin is not meeting God's standard. Sin means that we are broken. We're broken. And that's the condition of all of us before Christ. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That means that there's a penalty for our sin that must be paid. There's a price of that. But it says the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. Jesus paid the price. I know that I'm a sinner. I know that I cannot save myself. I know that my sin separates me. Lord, I believe. I want to place my faith and my trust in Jesus Christ alone. I want to lay my life in His hands. I want to ask Him to come into my heart, to live inside of me, to bring me, give me a life, and I'll be the Lord. Maybe you feel full of shame because of something that you've done. You know that your sins have been forgiven, but there's just that shame there, and you can't get it out of your mind. You might have been made to feel completely worthless. You know what? God can still use you. He can still use you, and He wants to use you.
Troubling you or been burdensome on your heart, go ahead and write that down on the rock.
Before you leave tonight, just bring up the rock to one of us, an adult, a youth, anybody, so we can be praying together, okay? I also want to tell you, we'd like a Bible. We got some New Testaments. And also, if you made a decision for Christ, I got a little booklet here that will help you grow in your faith. So if you made any kind of decision, if you like these materials, please let us know. And thank you again for letting us come. We're just going to close with a song. I know it's late, it's a long service, but we only get to come here once a year. We appreciate you being patient. But we wanted to just us share, but this is one of our favorite songs called You Never Let Go. And it's just a great message of how God loves us and he's working.